Yes, Geeta, we can start now.
Okay. Hello, friends. Thank you for being here. I am Geeta Ramamurthy. I'm the charter member and the governing board member of Thai Boston chapter, Thai Bangalore chapter. And I'm also the chairperson of the Thai Women Entrepreneur Program. We call it as TWE for short, of Thai Bangalore chapter. TWE Bangalore is a business plan competition to start with. And at the chapter level, we have a business plan competition towards the end of every year. And the first place winner, they travel to Dubai and compete for the TWE global prize of $100,000. And I'll talk a little bit about the Thai Global Program. This was launched in 2020, about 2 years ago. And here is our success story. 3,000 plus pitch applications, 500 plus mentor sessions, 30 plus countries participated, 250 plus women-led startups accelerated, 41 chapter winners, and of course, two first place winners at the global level in the past 2 years. And most important, $1 million was raised by the women entrepreneurs who participated in this program. Now, coming back to the TWE Bangalore program, it has been the number one chapter worldwide in the past 2 years, 2020 and 2021, for receiving the highest number of registrations. And it is also the recipient of the Best Chapter Lead Award worldwide. You know why it is so exciting, to talk about the TWE program? It's not because it's in addition to the efforts of all of us, but the most important thing is exciting partnerships. We have been able to partner with a lot of incubators, accelerators, organizations, and finally this year we are partnering with the government of Karnataka. We are extremely proud of that project that is going to be launched sometime later this year. That is the exciting part of the TWE Bangalore. Now, without much ado, I am delighted and honored to introduce a legend in his own right who has served IIMB. Also a combination of IIMB NSR cell for the past 14 years. He is Professor Suresh Bhagwatula. And what he says is, as part of the NS Raghavan Center for Entrepreneurship and Entrepreneur Learning at IIM Bangalore, I am focused on teaching entrepreneurship, and also I support startups. And I also am very much involved in the research. Professor Bhagwatula, welcome to this program. Now I'm going to introduce Miss Priya Chetty Rajgopal. She is the charter member, governing board member of Thai Bangalore. And most important, she's the chairperson and the co-chair of the TWE Bangalore program and the Women Entrepreneur Special Interest Group program in Bangalore, which focuses on learning, workshops, mentor connects, investor connects, and network connects. And above all, Priya is a great friend, and she will be coming a little bit later and introducing the moderator and the participants in this program. Thank you so much. And welcome to all of you. Now I'll pass it on to Professor Bhagwatula so he can talk about the NSR cell partnership with the Goldman Sachs. We are very, very excited to hear about that program. Thank you.
Thank you.
Professor, it's all yours.
Thank you very much for the kind introduction. Good afternoon, everyone. I guess as days go by, we'll get back to physical, but online is actually quite convenient from the comforts of our rooms. We don't have to really travel too far, but that takes off the human interactions that we would have had, or the more important casual conversations that would lead up to something interesting at some other point of time in life. So thank you very much for doing this event. Just to introduce our program, this is a standard program that Goldman Sachs does across the world, what is known as a 10,000 Women program. Of late, they seem to have two programs, one which is completely online and one which is offline. When I say offline, I mean not because of COVID, but the fact is that they were trying to move entirely to an online course, but in certain countries, they decided to continue with the classroom courses that they had earlier. So India is one of those countries where they continue to have offline. So we did about 5 batches before COVID hitting us. So we moved entirely online since last 2020 April. But the current batch, we're doing hybrid. About 50 participants, or 50% of the group is in classroom and 50% are signed in as of today. So it's good to have some people in class and some people outside, because not everybody has the degrees of freedom to come or would be able to come all the time. So in a way, having a hybrid perhaps would increase the footprint in terms of who gets to be part of it. So what is this program about? This program is a general management program for women entrepreneurs who have the ventures between 30 crores and 30 lakhs and 3 crores. So for women who have started the ventures and have seen some early success, many of them hit a glass ceiling in terms of what to do next. And we don't have to go on to say that the gravity for women entrepreneurs is completely restricted compared to entrepreneurs or men. Women don't have mentors, women don't have training, women get about 2% of VC money. So the gravity is very, I would say, sadly distributed for women entrepreneurs. We take up training. So it's a 3-week, 15-day training program, which we have across 3 weeks, where we impart general management principles. And our objective is to get them to start think of their own venture differently and be able to scale, thanks to the newer management paradigms that they have, some confidence in terms of what they can do. And also mainly the cohort that starts to develop amongst themselves. So we have 3-week program. Week one is to look out what you can do. Week two is about what you can do to your venture. And week three is about what you can do to yourself as an entrepreneur, as a decision maker. What are the ways in which you could improve yourself? We have seen some very good successes. Most of the people who have gone through the program have scaled their ventures at least 15 to 20% or even more. And very importantly, they have a huge network that support each other, because our cohorts are about 100 now. When it was completely classroom, we had about 40. But now, because of this hybrid and online, we have been able to take the numbers to about 100. We've gone up to 125. I think 100 is a good number. So if you are, or if you know somebody who's an entrepreneur and you would like to be trained, take a pause and relook at their own venture and see what is it that they can do, this is a wonderful program to be part of. And the best part is Goldman Sachs pays for all of it. It's free, right? So thanks a lot. I do hope that some of you all will consider applying for this program and coming and joining us and being part of this cohort. Thank you very much and look forward.
Great. So, Geeta, with your permission.
Yeah, go ahead, Priya.
All right.
You can take over.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Geeta. Suresh, thank you so much for that wonderful introduction and also setting in context what a wonderful program this is for you know, women entrepreneurs who are looking at scaling up, adding value, gaining more confidence and going all out. And you've mentioned the magic word, you know, that it is something which is free. It is hosted by two of the biggest names. IIM Bangalore is such a wonderful NSRCL, such a good name to have on your, you know, on your CV or, you know, with your bankers, and being part of the Goldman Sachs, you know, 10,000 is something else also. So great opportunity for all of us here in this group, Suresh. It's for Thai, for the wonderful women here, the panelists. So for Thai women, and it's been a tremendous last few years. I want to quickly just add a bit of an insight. I was just Googling a minute ago and I saw Hema, that one of the first talks in the third incarnation of Thai women in 2013, this was, has a talk with you and Revathi, and you know, many interesting conversations, which I've just sent a link on the group too. So as I said, you know, it's a circle, you know, it all comes around one way or the other. But on a more serious note, what Geeta has been talking about in terms of Thai has been actually just the tip of the iceberg, because there has been so much that has been done by a phenomenal secretariat, by a great team of people, several different special interest groups, in making sure not just that the contest that we're doing globally with TWE, the linkages that we have across Thai women in India and globally are being leveraged, but also looking at local opportunities where we can add value and take value. And what Geeta was talking about from the perspective of the government, you know, the scheme that we're starting off with, especially with district and rural women, is going to be extraordinary, because it's a uniquely Thai Bangalore women event and I initiative, and it's something that I think will have lasting value and much larger ripples than anything that has been attempted before. So that's been really great. And Geeta and, you know, Geeta has been an extraordinary chair, has been collaborative and pushing this through. We really wouldn't be here without having somebody like her really, really, you know, sort of focused on pushing the initiative forward, creating the most amount of value. And everyone who's here, who's interacted with her, knows that value creation and creating, you know, positivity is a very large part of what Geeta and the Thai women have been doing so far. So thank you, Geeta, for that. And I want to sort of, I actually sort of just pushed myself in, because I was so excited that Hema was moderating. And I said, I must have a chance to quickly introduce her. And Hema is an absolute legend. And I, of course, take full credit, because my classmate is her classmate and I am. So, of course, we're like that. And the second thing is, she's done such extraordinary things. And we are so lucky to have her here in this program today, because here is a woman who not only has gone through corporate, has set up her own business, worked with a family enterprise, has motivated and looked at several other, you know, women initiatives that she could help or empower, also has been acquired by a company like Schneider, has moved on to create social value, and has done some tremendous things for not only women entrepreneurship, but a lot of other initiatives, just specifically, you know, CSR is a very wide and horrendous term, so I'm going to move on from there. But she and I have also worked together in terms of civic initiatives. We both are on governing council of something called BNP, and we work very hard to make the city, which is also, Shika, Suresh, as you might know, one of your own IMB alumnus initiative. So there is so much we have in common, but what I love is her constant reinvention of herself and a constant desire to want to give back, without sounding like Mother Teresa. I'm just saying, you know, that constant saying, hey, listen, what do we do to make this, make this a better place? So whether you look at, you know, building up her organization, Conserve, brick by brick, working through a definite, you know, it was very different in those days. You know, you're looking at so many different dynamics that had to be leveraged. You're looking at, you know, sharing those learnings and challenges at that time, the transitions that the company went through with, and it's very interesting that she chose the subject of, you know, how to scale up with very little money, because that's really such a critical issue for all of us in entrepreneurship today. And that's part of her story as well, you know, building with a shoestring budget. You know, and I know that her story at Conserve is a Harvard Business School case study, and it has been something that has been referred to several times. And the reason why perhaps, you know, Schneider took over Conserv is a story by itself. And I think that sometime we need to read, Hema, we need to read your novel, not novel, your story.
It's non-fiction.
Non-fiction, I know. But, you know, we can always pretend and there'll be somebody, you know, Julia Roberts taking on your role in the film. Who knows? Who knows? But
we are making a film, Priya.
See? See? I'm just so prescient. I'm amazing. Who's playing you?
Yet to be revealed. It's a secret.
All right. The Conserv for Planet and Campus is something that is what Hema is looking at. And she, I think, is very interesting to me because she does not define success in the same way that most people do. And Hema will always be a very real, authentic, committed woman of business, of India, and somebody who has a lot to be able to share, not just on this particular topic, which I think is critical, but also on many other issues on being a better entrepreneur and a better person. So Hema, delighted. And thanks so much for allowing me to bamboozle my way in here. I'm so looking forward to this conversation. I want to quickly introduce, and I leave Hema to do this, but we've got Akshita Ashok, who's the co-founder and chief legal officer of Sama. And she's done some very interesting things, but she is, looks at creating a society where people deal with conflicts in a collaborative and peaceful manner. So she's got mediators across 26 cities. And so mediation and technology, that's quite a combination to get justice in India. Akshita and I also, which we did not realize, are part of the same animal squad that helps dogs and other animals and communities in Indranagar. So we keep bumping into each other there and look surprised that we have these different avatars. So hey, Akshita, always good to see you in whatever avatar. You're an amazing person. Lovely to see you through that whole last episode of Dai and how well you've done and what you've what you've achieved. Prapti Jaiswal, co-founder and CEO at Arogya AI, focusing on using machine learning in healthcare for rapid diagnosis and effective treatment. But what I remembered about Prapti in the series of meetings that we had the last time was her tremendous energy and her positivity and her focus on getting something done and taking people along with her. She has a quality which I think entrepreneurs should have, which is a never say die attitude and a warm optimism, which something that cannot be undermined. Really, really good. So Prapti, good to see you here again. Vasanthi, I remember, is doing something very interesting, and she specializes in regenerative medicine based therapeutics for male and female infertility, and does the whole gamut from tissue engineering to in vitro cell, molecular and immunological assays, mammalian cell culture, and several other things that leave me completely befuddled, but completely impressed. Vasanthi, really good to see you here and the work that you do. Aishwarya Biswas, who is the founder of Auli, which is active Ayurveda skincare. And she's been on Shark Tank. She's been on the Thai Global Women's Pitch. And she's had so many different credits, including being the top 100 women entrepreneur of the Fiki Flow event, the YFLO Achiever, ET Now Awardee. So we've got some real stars here with you, Hema. I'm going to hand it over to you to do the needful, but I can tell you that I am looking forward to this conversation with a lot of interest. And who knows, I think all of us have something that we'd like to take away from here. So take it away, Hema.
Thank you, Priya. Thank you, Geeta. And thank you to the Thai team for making this happen. And good afternoon, everybody. I'm absolutely delighted to be amongst a very, very special group of young achievers. I, you know, look at the average age and I feel really old. And it's on a topic that would, like Priya said, interest every entrepreneur and business leader. The topic is scaling on a shoestring budget. It almost sounded like an oxymoron to me. I'd forgotten what times we lived in when I ran Conserv. But I'm hoping that the panelists, in answering the questions that come up and in talking about how they scale their businesses, are going to tell us how it's perfectly possible and achievable. And indeed, it's something that we should learn to do, doing more with less. And I must say that when I looked at the backgrounds of the people who are on the panel today, I must hand it to the team that selected them because it's a very nice mix. Unfortunately, Priya, Vasanthi couldn't join us today. I understand that she wasn't well at all, but did somehow wanted to, she did want to be here, but I think Geeta advised her that it's she's better off taking rest.
Yeah.
So we are going to miss out on that amazing conversation, but maybe we can do a special one only with her because she's in an amazing area too.
Absolutely.
So, yeah, I like that idea.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
In fact, you know, I was just thinking, when you look at each of the verticals these entrepreneurs are in, they deserve an hour to themselves, right? So today we are just going to get a flavor of it all. And I think the reason that this is really special is that all these entrepreneurs have not only grown quickly since inception, but they operate in not so easy areas. In fact, if you just Google them or look at their LinkedIn profiles, you'll see that each of them is in something that is not, you know, one wouldn't think that it's very easy to do.
Yeah.
And the mix today, I'm hoping, will give us and the audience a kind of a takeaway for, it doesn't matter what kind of sector you are in, there's going to be something in it for all of you. And I'm really hoping that you folks out there are going to keep this thing completely interactive. Shreya at the back end has a very nice flow organized so that we can bring everybody's questions in together somewhere around 3/4 of the way through the program. So I'm now going to ask the panelists about if they could, in their opening remarks, tell us something, some element, either about their business model or the industry that you are in or the specific business that you run, that will throw some definitive light on the topic of today, which is scaling on a shoestring budget. Priya has already highlighted some of the things that I found very interesting in all of them. I'll just jump into it a little before I get to the questions or the opening remarks. Just wanted to say that I found in Akshata's profile something very interesting. You know, her motto is that Stama, her organization, uses technology and knowledge so that as the week ends, so can your dispute. Who wouldn't want that? I found that so amazing and so well put. Hats off, because, you know, as I found out in Conserve, half the story is being able to articulate and position your what you're doing well to the outside world. And I think that's amazingly done, quite apart from the fact that at the core, you have a really unbeatable mix of technology and an area of conflict resolution, which I think all of us need, unfortunately, at some point in our life. I also noticed, Akshata, and maybe you can talk about this when you start diving into this, is you've set up a very interesting bunch of partners. You know, you have a knowledge partner, you have a technology partner, you have an ecosystem partner. And I found all of that very interesting and new age. So Akshata, do talk a little bit about that. I'm going to jump to Prapti Jaiswal, whose Arogya AI aims to save lives by combining genomics with AI for precision diagnosis to antimicrobial resistance. And all of us hear about antimicrobial resistance every time there is a new disease and there is a bacteria out there and an antibiotic that's coming out. We listen to doctors almost kind of frustrated with the pace at which they can conquer something because of the resistance that is being developed. So Prapti, amazing area, but I found something even more interesting than what you're doing, which is the fact that you were a state level cricketer and you played softball and soccer. And hats off to you, because I love people who can combine an interest in sports. And I also saw you got an award for excellence in sports and chemistry. Amazing. And kudos on your fundraise too. You've raised repeated rounds, so well done, and Godspeed in the future. The third panelist today is Aishwarya Biswas. Her company is called Oli, and it's active Ayurveda for skincare. Now, Aishwarya, I have to have an in-depth discussion with you, perhaps one-on-one, because I really find this field to be very challenging and tough, especially in India, and I'll tell you why. I'm not saying it for the regular reasons that one might think, but it's because I think customers in India, especially for beauty and skincare products, are very trusting. This whole thing about fair and lovely, and you know where that debate went. But the fact that people don't often question the quality, the certification, the ingredients that go into the product, they don't even understand. Maybe I should speak for myself. I don't understand the science that goes behind the cream that I lather on my face at night, right? So the onus, in a way, this is my perspective, ends up on the company to be transparent and to be ethical about what they're doing, because you're actually dealing with a very, very sensitive area. And the other thing, Aishwarya, and I'd like you to discuss this when you start talking, is that we live in an age of virality, right? So it's equally easy to get famous overnight, and it's also equally easy to get bad reviews. So when you use a lot of social media, as you do for your marketing and your promotions, talk a little bit about how you manage fallouts which weren't intended. I think it's very, very important for all of us who live in this day and age of virality. And I, Priya talked a little bit about my experience in growing Conserve, but I must tell you that firstly, Conserve, just to set a little bit of context, was in the energy meter manufacturing business, and we grew it to India's largest energy management services company. We almost never had enough money compared to the competition. I mean, there wasn't a single day or a month or a quarter where I could wake up and say, I've got my plan, I've got my vision, I've got my quarterly targets, and thank God, view, I have enough money to do it with. So it was always doing more with less. There were two or three things that I tried out which worked, but I'm going to save that for the end because today is not about me. It's all about you. So I'm going to quickly turn it over to all of you to start with your opening remarks on the topic of today, scaling on a shoestring budget. So would Akshita, would you like to go first?
Sure, thank you. So, good afternoon, everyone. It's so lovely to be here. And I think this topic is also incredible. Sama literally lives and breathes this topic. So we really get it. I think a quick disclaimer, anything that I would share today is very specific to what we've done at Sama, what I've seen, what I've dealt with, and very specific to our industry, which is legal tech, and within that, online dispute resolution. So just sharing, if something strikes or someone has a takeaway from it, that would be great. But just a little bit about Sama, we're an online dispute resolution platform. The idea is your legal cases should not take years, should not take so much money, and should not be this cumbersome to solve. Access to justice is for everyone. Right now, is that the case? No. But that's the problem Sama is trying to solve. So more efficient, more cost-effective, collaborative, and completely online. So that is a little bit about Sama. And our motto is Suljhao Magar Pyar Se, which is resolve, but with compassion. And Sama was actually, Hema, you had said, you know, tell us one element that really shows that it's a shoestring budget. We were college entrepreneurs. So I think that says it all. Sama started when we were in college. And Pranjal and I, my other co-founder, were lawyers by profession. Third co-founder is an engineer. And I think as we move on, I would love to share a little more, but if there were two things that really made it work with a shoestring budget, is one, that's not a bad word. It's not a bad phrase. We're really okay with it. We actually really like it. We really enjoy it. One is the why has been very strong. Access to justice for all has been very strong in the Sama mind and Sama ecosystem within us. And that has been a big driver, irrespective of how much money or how much was available. I also feel a shoestring budget really allows you to stress test your why, and whether you're really in a space and you're really as passionate as you think you are, or you really want to make it in that space. And the second would just be resources versus resourcefulness. I think that is a super, super, there's a key difference there. And these are the two things that I think keep Sama going, and would just love to hand it over to the next person and share as we go. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Well said, Akshita. Prapti, would you like to go next?
Oh, absolutely. Thank you very much for the very kind and warm introductions. Like, it's always such a joy to be here, and never before on a panel has it been outed that I've played sport, like state level. So I'm super excited. Thank you for bringing it up. And I'm actually going to quickly talk about how sport and board gaming have inspired me in understanding constraints. So a shoestring budget, for example, is a direct indication of resource limited settings or constraints. And one of the things that, you know, struck me when I read the title of this conversation for the first time, I don't think any amount of money is ever enough. So there was some conversation about context, and it's so true, because I've never seen someone saying, hey, we have enough money. Everyone's always in a constraint for money, irrespective of what they're building out. But coming back to Arogya AI, we set out to, again, from our PhD, my co-founder was my colleague in the same lab. We were both molecular and microbiologists. She is a coder for biological data. She's a bioinformatician. So together, we wanted to apply our scientific education and knowledge in biology to combat infectious diseases. This is a pre-pandemic idea. So in 2019, we were like, people are not getting effective medication. It's ridiculous that this day and age, people are employing machine learning and artificial intelligence to get rich people even richer. We need to do this so that people can be healthy and be prescribed effective medication. Now, these pathogens, these bacteria, these viruses have been evolving from the beginning of time, since the time of the mummies of Tutankhamun. You found the Mycobacterium tuberculosis sitting right there, pretty. It's evolving. And the rate at which these pathogens are evolving is way faster than the rate at which we're inventing new drugs to kill them. And that's not okay. We have all of these technologies being employed in fintech and real estate. Why can't we do that in health? So much research has gone in. It's up to us to translate that research into real-world application. So we look at the DNA of the bacteria, at the genomes of these organisms, apply machine learning and other pattern recognition algorithms to better understand them, to enable doctors to make more clinical decisions that will make better informed treatment outcomes. So the whole point here that we're trying to create is that the antibiotics that exist are used more effectively to combat this great surge of antimicrobial resistance that can lead to the next pandemic, which nobody on this planet and the universe, I'm assuming, wants. So that's where Arogya AI sees itself contributing to humanity. And like I said earlier, one of the biggest things a data company or a machine learning company needs is data. And what I'd love to talk about going forward in this conversation is how we were able to generate or get access to data or scale that data to make our algorithms more and more effective on a shoestring budget. So as researchers, we came out of our PhDs and our degrees to build a startup. What we were probably naive and didn't know what we were signing up for, but we don't have access to millions and trillions of dollars that probably a West Coast San Francisco startup does. But what we had access to was scale and number of patients in India, unfortunately. So, you know, being able to utilize resources, not just money, so what money can probably cannot even buy, is one of my biggest takeaways for this discussion going forward.
Great. Thank you so much, Prapti. Aishwarya, would you like to go next? Your quick opening remark.
Okay. Hi, everyone. My name is Aishwarya. I am the founder of Oli. And just quickly, I wanted to tell you guys that money is never enough, like you already heard. But, you know, somewhere, I think two things that if I would want to, put forward, saying that, you started by saying it's a competitive market, but why this? But two things. A is that, if people who still don't know why is the skin as an organ, why is it important and why we should take care of it? That is the problem, right? And most of us don't know, and hence conviction of about your own product and how it's substantially superior than most in the market. That conviction, I think, leads us to kind of identify what is the problem that you're trying to solve. And then we kind of believe that we'll educate you first and then take you on a skincare journey. So that's more from where we come from, where we come from as a brand, is to educate each and every person so that they can take a well thought through decision as to what they want to invest in their skincare process, because really it is something more of a need than a greed, and that needs to go through to each and everyone who's using an Oli product. So that's how we started. And I'm good at it in terms of understanding the formulations, understanding how you can save money, not go to a dermatologist and spend a lot of money after a problem has been created already, but try and not let it happen in the first place. So I think, because I'm good at it, because I'm passionate about it, this is what I decided to do with my life. And, I think That's exactly what I'm going to spend most of my life trying to do. And of course, about being on a budget, I think when your product speaks on its own, then there is a way to survive in this kind of a cutthroat marketing-driven industry by having a good product in your hand and letting your customers do the talking. So I can proudly say that Oli has a 75% repeat customer rate, which is not even a 7% when it comes to competing brands. And that in itself, you know, helps me be on a, you know, shoestring budget. Maybe it's a bad thing because I don't have the risk-taking appetite now for spending a lot on marketing, because I have managed to do quite a bit without that spend. So maybe that, you know, that's a challenge which I'll talk about later. But, you know, that's I think that's a good way of letting your customers do the talking and then be on a budget or save that money on marketing.
Fantastic. Thank you, Aishwarya. That was very succinct. So now I'm going to dive into a few questions that came up to me from the audience as soon as the mailer went out. So obviously this is really top of mind for everybody, and why wouldn't it be, right? The question is, tell us what you would do or what you have done to grow profitably, even as you face well-funded competitors, perhaps, who are burning their way to acquire customers, because no one operates in a vacuum, right? The next disruptor is around the corner. It could be technology, it could be business model, it could be anything. So tell us, for each of your businesses, what is it that you do when you face well-funded competitors? You could take it any order. Would Prapti like to go first?
Yeah, happy to. So one of the core ingredients that are necessary for what our startup does is genomic sequencing. And genomic sequencing in today's day and age is now made popular by COVID. So everyone knows that you, you know, read the DNA. But the hardware to do the sequencing costs a certain amount of money. It's expensive. It's the most expensive thing to build this product. Now, that was one of our biggest questions. We got of, why do you have to fundraise? You have to fundraise because you need to do sequencing. The cool thing that we got an opportunity to do was the biggest sequencing hardware company in the world is called Illumina. And we got into their accelerator program. They invested in us. So a strategic investment is, I think, leaps and bounds more significant in our process. So we didn't have to raise a few million dollars to do that same thing. Just having them as a strategic investor really changed the game for us, because now we had them backing us, and that helped us enhance our database, grow it exponentially to be strong and robust and up and running in a couple of years, which is really hard to do. I think that really, Hema, set us apart and set us going, essentially. And that was one of the reasons we were able to unlock these potentials. You talked a little bit earlier about partners. I think partnerships are crucial in this day and age. It's not just about the money, but the acumen and the experience and the multiple other awesome things that different people can bring. So I think for me and Arogya AI in our growth, a strategic partnership from Illumina really upped our game, helped up our game, and it helps that they're San Francisco based. So we had exposure to thought process of, you know, the best in the world, best in the business, raising probably 10 times as much as we were. But in the context of India, we were being able to, you know, spend very little, but grow just as quickly. So that was one of the most breakthrough fun things that happened for us.
Before I go to the next panelist, I just wanted to ask you, you know, you made it seem very simple, and I'm sure it can't have been, that there was this wonderful accelerator program and you got into it. Can you tell me what helped you do that? Was it your, you know, you were looking around all the time for something, you were intuitive, you had networks, you were well informed. Sometimes opportunity knocks at the door and we don't let it in, right? And then we can rue the fact. And I hear you say that it was one of this thing, Illumina and that accelerator program and that strategic investment helped you to do the rest, right? It was like a multiplier effect. So if it was so critical, what was the one thing that helped you to do that?
Yeah, great question, Hima. I'm so glad you asked, because for 1.5 years before that, we toiled and struggled and didn't know how to get sequencing done. People were giving us quotes of 48 lakhs and 68 lakhs and 93 lakhs. And we were like, how do I get that money? There is no way. And you go to an investor and it's like a chicken and egg problem. You go to an investor and they're like, oh, have you built this out? Do you have sales and you have this and that? And we're like, this is not that kind of e-commerce model of building. We're trying to build a scientific product here that requires R&D. So they say, go into an R&D setup, do research. But that's an academic point of view. So the whole point of doing this was translating that to real world application, but where do you get money to do that? So we were looking everywhere. We were trying to make academic collaborations to do it. They couldn't believe that we were talking about the numbers. Like, they were like, who talks about 1,000 TB samples? They do about 4 or 5 and publish an article. Not to trivialize research. It is the bare basis of what has brought us to this point today to apply it. But this is something we want to really build out at scale. And it can only be done because the power of numbers can help us. But how do we sequence these many samples? You need to raise money, which we don't have access to. So my co-founder actually found the Illumina Accelerator. We were the first Indian startup to be on it because we were like, why would someone sitting in San Francisco care about a TB product? So we had no hopes, to be very honest. And again, this was all pre-pandemic. So infectious disease and diagnosis was not sexy right now, right? So no one's bothered. So we went and applied for it saying, hey, you know, what if this works out? It'll be fun. We were looking at the 100K that they come with. What we didn't realize was the actual power that a strategic investment comes with. So, you know, it was a toil of a year and a half before we found this amazing opportunity. So thank you for asking that question.
Great. Thank you so much. So Akshita, would you like to go next? Just to repeat, the question was, how do you face up to well-funded competition while you yourself are trying to scale on a shoestring budget? That was the discussion.
Got it. Thank you. So as I said, it was we were still in college when this was being conceptualized. And the idea was just coming back to the whole resources versus resourcefulness. It's okay. It's really okay if money is not there right now. There are so many other things that you can really, really use to really set yourself on the right path. You know, the minute your why is clear, which could be mentorship, which could be anything you have access to. So just a couple of anecdotes from summer, right? So we're building a technology platform to be able to solve these disputes. Are we going to get, like, who's going to do that? Where are we going to find it? One of our co-founders is an engineer. We just started. He built our first platform completely alone, right? When we were in college, again, one thing that we had is we were good at relationship building. We started literally going on the streets and telling people with pamphlets that you don't need to go to court every time you have a dispute. It was just a group of 10 of us that did it in Calcutta. And then within 2 years, we were the largest student-run access to justice campaign. Every college in almost every city had an ambassador that were going out on the streets. So the following year, when we were on the streets talking to people, we knew that there were at least another 3,000, 4,000 kids doing it at the exact same time. And yeah, there's no money, but we had a Xerox person in college. We had our voice, and all we did was go out there, find a group of like-minded students who are willing to work in the impact space. And you're looking at, in 2 years and 3 years, the largest student-run access to justice campaign. Money spent, it was just this is how we did it, right? And similar to what Prapti said, there was an EADR challenge, basically a global challenge to see who can build an online dispute resolution platform for India. Again, we were in our fifth year. We just, exactly like Prapti said, we're like, we'll just give it a go. And we won that. And what you get from that is ICICI Bank as your first client. So we left our fifth year of college saying that one of our users is ICICI Bank, who's giving us 10,000 disputes to work on the platform that Vikram built. So, and it's funny, like when you look back, you know, when people say, oh, lucky, oh, no, it's exactly what Prapti said. There was a lot of work that you just take that step, you take that next step. You're not thinking, oh, I'm going to build that house, but you're just almost collecting bricks. And then one day an opportunity knocks and you look back and you're like, oh, I have around like 3,000 already. I don't know how that happened. We just followed the right direction. So, yeah, I think that's sort of how it's been. And
I just want to say, Akshita, thank you for that, because you talked, ended up talking about opportunity knocking. Mm-hmm. I like to quote this American comedian called Milton Berle, who said, if opportunity doesn't knock, build a door. And it sounds like, I mean, at least from all your stories, I can tell so far that you guys have done a combination of both. When it did knock, You were there to receive it. And when it wasn't knocking, you built a door for it to knock. So I think amazing stories. And I like this thing that you repeated about resourcefulness and not necessarily resources. I can see where that played a big part in your story. Aishwarya, would you like to take a stab at how you've been scaling on a shoestring budget while your competitors are very large and well-funded and have a lot to burn? Aishwarya? Have you lost her? Okay, so while we're waiting for her to come back, why don't we get into my next question, which is about a time window to scale before your competitors outrun you. What do you do if you don't have that luxury? Oh, hey, Aishwarya, you were muted. Do you want to take a stab now? Yeah, go ahead.
Hi, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, so quickly, I just wanted to say that, you know, for me, it has always been that I have to be patient because I've never had the money that my competitors would have. Also because I never wanted that money also. Till the time, I was very sure about the product. It's only after my third year into business when I patiently walked my each and every customer through the product, saw relevant results, and I was sure that, okay, this is something that is life-changing, that I went on national television and I said that I want to now take it to everyone. Because I now know that this is a good, you know, this is a good way of doing it. This is the right, I've done a lot of research myself, a lot of layers of products that have been, tested. There have been processes that have been tested. I've gone through that only then. I've realized very quickly that, you know, if I kept burning money, then it would be like a downward trend for us without knowing what do we have, whether we have gold in our hand. So I think patience is something that you have to, you know, have, and conviction. These are the two thing pillars on which, you know, you cannot lose hope. For us, you know, when everybody is burning money, right in my face, right in my backyard, I can't lose hope thinking that that person will spend an obnoxious amount of money to acquire customers. But my customers are here to stay. That is what the win is. So if you're not greedy to make big numbers initially, then I think your base becomes that much stronger where you now it's a matter of multipliers. Maybe then if the product wasn't that great, then if the money would have been spent also, it would have been a short-lived kind of result I would have gotten that time. Yeah. But if I have that money now to burn, now I know exactly what to do with it. So to some amount of, you know, you cannot be greedy, especially where you are fighting in a big competitive market. And that's what I have done.
Okay, thanks, Aishwarya. I just wanted to ask you guys about this, you know, the time window that one gets when one is running an operational business. I think, yeah. How do you manage that before your competitors outrun you? What do you do if you don't have that luxury?
Jaldi chale, baad mein karenge.
Prapti, would you like to go first?
Sure, why not? So time is, it's pesky. Okay, it's very dangerous. Yes, you don't want your competitors to outrun you, but that really cannot be something that drives, especially a startup like ours in the healthcare space. We have to be precise. We have to really, be right, and then fast. Because if we're not right in prescribing medication, we're not solving the problem. We're really adding to the problem. So we're very calculated about time. So we don't want to create false time pressures or rushes, because science takes time. We've taken 2.5 years to build out what we've built out. It's a significant amount of time to build something out. But I think one of the most important things for us is, you know, we have to be right and bring it out. This is the right time to attack an infectious disease market. The other thing that adds to me not being particularly afraid of competitors outrunning us is the fact that the market is huge. It's big enough for all of us to not just exist, but thrive in, especially in the context of infectious diseases. If there are people who are offering solutions, better solutions, it's more like a, what can we learn from them and also build that and put that out. So that's how I see this question. Yeah.
So Prapti, obviously the calculation of the market sizing, how big it was a very, very important decision-making factor when you got into this, right? Because I think the second part of this question, what do you do if you don't have that luxury? I think the thing is to make sure that you've gotten into an area where the market is big enough for you to do what you can do at your pace and not mess it up just because you don't have the money. Yeah.
Most definitely. I think so.
Yeah. Akshita, would you like to talk about this, the time window factor?
Yeah, I think it's something we've heard a lot, saying you don't want to miss the train, you don't want to miss the bus, you don't want to miss the plane, you know, all of it. One thing is, if you don't have your product or your service down, like if you don't, what will we do if we have so much money, but we're not able to solve your dispute correctly and as fast as it can be or as efficiently, right? So I think really taking that time to just build it out, like build that foundation, make sure, because the window will be there, but it also depends on what you're bringing at the time of the window or the train or the bus leaving. So just if the focus can be on that, I think that's where our focus has been at Sama, especially ODR still being nascent. And it is so important for us to sort of make sure that the foundation is super strong. That's sort of the approach that we've taken. And perfect. Another thing which I've seen constantly would be, why, right? Is it because you want to be called a unicorn, or is it actually going to help with the impact? Are you okay not being called a unicorn right now? Absolutely. We just want to make sure that the end of the week your dispute's resolved. Like that's
brilliant.
That's
really talk important. About focus, laser sharp focus on the purpose. Thank you, Akshita. Aishwarya, you want to go next?
Yes, I'm good to go next. Just ask me the question one more time. I'm actually in
Sure. What we are discussing now is about the time window that you get to scale while you have your competition out there outrunning you. What do you do if you don't have that luxury? How do you deal with it? What do you do in the business?
You have to, in the world of virality, I think if for a company like mine, I would want to take more innovative ways to kind of outrun, you know, my competitors. I would want to, you know, use as many innovative marketing ways to catch the attention of my customers. I would depend very heavily on my customers, their reviews and their actual feedback to compete with, you know, the marketing brand ambassadors of very many. So I would want to make my own customers my brand ambassadors. Make them do the talking instead of, you know, very highly paid brand ambassadors in this case. So these are basically try all other means or innovative means to kind of grab the attention of the end user. And also, I think what worked for us is that we empowered the end user with information. And that, I think, you know, nobody else was spending time on doing that. And they also had a face to the story. Like, it was not only the product, it was like at least me or somebody from my team or our CRM representatives. They were all we were kind of like mentors to each and every customer, where we should take them through the entire process of skincare and then give a solution. So I think those kind of having a person to kind of fall back on, or saying that, okay, I'm using it on me, you know, so you can also use it on you because of these many reasons. I think these are the things that, you know, this multiplied by, of course, you know, where you want to see the company reach in terms of scale. I think those are the kind of steps one should take when they are on a shoestring.
Okay. Thanks, Aishwarya. So the next question is about, in any startup, you always have constraints, right? It's money, people, time, geography, etc. So what mechanisms have you employed to make decisions when money is a constraint, and what are the consequences? Can you look back and say, hey, you know, when we had these constraints, we took this decision, I'm glad we did that because of XYZ happening? Or are there some decisions that we are forced to take where looking back, you're not so happy, and what could one have done about it? Would you like to share some stories or anecdotes from your experiences. And I see a note, we have 5 minutes to close this, and then we are opening it up to audience questions. So let's have some quick thoughts around this. Mechanisms for decision making when you are faced with constraints.
I think I can go first.
Yeah, Prapti, please.
So the pandemic was one of the most interesting times I think our generation has ever lived through. I think, and obviously geography was a massive constraint. We had, essentially this was pre-Illumina, so we didn't have enough money. But everybody across the world, kids especially, were not having to go to college, so they freed up a lot of time. And they were interested in infectious disease. The interest in infectious disease was off the charts. So we had people reaching out saying, hey, can we intern with you for a month or 2 months or 3 months? So in a limited setting where we couldn't really employ people to write our code and build a few things that we needed to build out, we outsourced these little things to interns from the United States, from Singapore, from Japan, because they were interested. And it was one of those decisions saying, hey, will an intern be able to do this? And it was really exciting to see how they took to actually contributing to something. So one of the things we learned was, you know, you don't trivialize someone without a degree, less, you know, it's just that there is intent, they have time, they have interest, and things get done. So that was one of the funnest things that came out of these constrained settings. And I had talked about in my introduction that I'm very inspired by sport and board games. So like everyone here has played Monopoly, right? So you've got Mayfair and Park Lane. Do you convert your thing into a house or a hotel when someone's coming? And that's the risk essentially you make. Do you spend the money to get more money? Or do you just let it go past, go take your 200 and get on with life? So we made these little punts and they've kind of worked out. So it's exciting.
Prapti, I think there was a question for you. Where do you find those interns? There's an audience question in the chat box. Where do you find them? What are good sources?
LinkedIn. I love LinkedIn. Just I'm very active on LinkedIn, and you just say, hey, looking for XYZ, and people will, at least through the pandemic, people really wanted to do something.
Right.
That continues today. It's a little harder. It's a little slower, but LinkedIn is my go-to place.
Okay. And there's a question from Sohruta to Aishwarya. You mentioned that you use innovative marketing. Can you elaborate that, especially how to market on a shoestring budget? Everybody would love to know that. Aishwarya
has dropped off. Probably there's a single issue.
Okay, fine. Shreya, if the time is up for the questions I had, do you want to open it up now to the audience?
Yes. So the participants can unmute themselves and come on audio and ask the questions.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes.
Post the question on the shoestring marketing budget. So if anybody who has their product out there and can respond to that, that would be great. Maybe Akshita, if you want to answer that. How do you market on a shoestring budget at scalable levels?
Got it. Okay. So one is we're from the legal space. So there are a lot of constraints on how much you can or can't do. But what we've done is we've been very strategic about where we put out information. We have over 3,500 lawyers and law students who work with us, who are empaneled to help us solve these cases. You're going to want to look for LinkedIn is probably a place where your large enterprise general counsels, the ones who are decision makers, they're probably over there. Facebook, for example, is really not the strongest place for summer to probably be putting out our information. So what we've done is really streamlined it into which particular service summer's talking about, who the target audience is, and then finding according sort of avenues to do so. One thing that did happen is, and I think it's pretty common, is every time we've been in the newspaper, the next 1 week has been a blast. Like, I don't even know where or how people reach us. That's been super effective.
Akshita, when you say when we were in the newspaper, this is not a press conference or publicity that you sought, but because of what you're doing, somebody wrote about you because you were newsworthy. You were talking about that kind of
Yeah, there was an Economic Times article on how dispute resolution is changing and you should be solving your cases differently. And they had named us. And,
okay, great. Awesome. That's interesting because, you know, at Conserve, just to bring in a little bit of flavor from the boring brick and mortar world of manufacturing meters, we also believe that hiring, press agents, publicity agents, and organizing press conferences, inviting the media was not a way of doing things. We believed, A, build a great culture. So people generally understand that cost optimization is something that benefits the company, the product, and themselves, and therefore give better value to customers. And the other was that if the product is made very well, and there is a demand for it, the product should speak for us. You know, we don't go out and hold press conferences about what we do, but customers should speak about the product quality. So let's invest all our time and our resources in building a great product. So I just wanted to add that to what you said, Akshata. Shreya, any more questions? Yeah, go ahead, Akshata.
Just to add, I think you touched upon a really, really cool point is that no one finds dispute resolution exciting at all. Okay, like people don't find it exciting. The people who need us also are probably really upset by the time they reach us. But we have like a really, really good communications head as well. And something that he does really well is that he explains what we do, which is actually really boring because it's like legal tech and all of that, in a very simple way. Sometimes when we talk to, like when I'm just talking to fellow lawyers, it's so much easier because everyone gets the lingo. But how are you going to tell someone else what legal process we're following? So also just focus on the content being really, really simple. Like sometimes I just make sure my parents read it, and if they say what, I'm like, okay, that's a fail. They have no clue what's going on.
Brilliant. Well said. Perfect. Shreya, anyone else?
Ma'am, my question is for Prapti. So Prapti shared the way of working with interns who are really excited to, create value and go beyond their college curriculum. So I'd like to understand that what really is of value to them. During 2020, we realized that a lot of interns want to work with us, but in the current scenario, like post the pandemic, we are seeing that they are more interested in a very heavy stipend as against the learning experience and creating something or actually contributing to a larger purpose.
Hey, Yukti, it's an interesting question, and there's all sorts of folk everywhere. There are those who are interested in a stipend. I mean, I think in 2020, I think the stipend was the last thing someone was thinking about. They were thinking about getting occupied for a while. Like college kids were really bored, and even so much Netflix is like, you still want to do something. So there was a bunch of those people. Yes, you're right. Off late, the biggest question is, okay, how much of a stipend do I get? So what we've got is, and being a biotech startup, we have a few government grants. And those grants aren't robust enough to give employees full-time salaries. So what we do is we carve out stipends for interns for short terms under those projects. So they're happy. But the stipends are in no way attractive. I mean, it's a, you know, there's a must-have and a nice-to-have. The must-have box can get checked. It's by no means a nice-to-have. I don't know if that solves... you know, the problem.
It provides a lot of validation. Thank you.
Right. Good luck.
Kavita?
So I have a...
Vibhuti?
Yeah.
One of you, please unmute and ask a question.
Yeah, I have a question for both Prapti regarding this interns. So as you said, interns is one mechanism where you can build some small things, validate them. But the problem is, how to demarcate your problem into such modules that could be integrated, because this is a different set of community. These are not like employees. You shouldn't get end up. We are talking about a very tight budget. Finally, you shouldn't burn too much by splitting the opportunity across different interns. So how do you manage that? Is it a lot of thought process that goes inside before splitting this?
Yeah, great question, Kavita. I think planning and then executing that plan is at the core of what you're asking. So my PhD and academic experience has allowed me, like it's ingrained in me to do a step one, step two, step three, then step one will have a step A, B, C, D, E, which will be further broken down into smaller steps. It's just how crazy we are, because that's how we build our scientific processes. So when we have been able to identify step 1A part 2 is going to be done by someone, and it could be something as simple as a heavy duty Google search in the biology databases. I'm just going to try to, you know, give you some context. So those things, you know, you give an intern like 3 days to look at 4 databases. So it's just articulating stuff, and it's just data put together. So you have to identify very clear goals and deliverables for these people. And it helps when you have 1 month or 2 months, because these are small things and it shows to them, they feel like they've actually contributed to something. And for us, they have actually contributed something meaningful. So it works both ways.
Beautiful. It's a win-win situation for both. They get experience and then you get work done.
And the joy they feel, contrast to, you know, sometimes interns are just reduced to bringing coffee. We want to change that.
Another question to Hema madam.
Yeah.
So it's off track. So I just wanted to understand. I come from an engineering background. I'm basically an electronics engineer. So did your non-engineering degree, though this is not directly related to what we are talking about, was it helpful in scaling up? Because many times engineers, we fear many things. This will not work out because we have our own assumptions. We have our own being out of this. Coming from a commerce degree, did it help scale up in a shoestring budget?
What a wonderful question. In fact, the answer to that is, I'm very, very convinced that I was probably able to see the size of where we could go and the path ahead, because I wasn't bogged down by the technicalities. I didn't understand a lot of the stuff. Of course, I did study the electrical engineering first year textbook, so I could at least sell to customers. But my picture was always from the customer's point of view and from the business point of view, and not necessarily that I had to build the most perfect, bestest product out there, which was actually the goal of my husband, as it rightly should be, because he's a head of R&D. And I wasn't bogged down by all of that. So yes, I think a brilliant question. And the fact that I was non-technical, I think indeed helped me to, you know, look at the bigger picture much better.
I would just want to connect with you sometime. I'll get the details from the organizer.
Absolutely. Welcome.
I'm working on some e-charging mechanism. So I'll just sync with you for some time.
Sure. Okay. Shreya, who else? No more hands up, etc. Okay, so if you don't have any more questions, is there one final thought all of you would like to leave the panelists? A message of hope and optimism for all the entrepreneurs out there who are listening to you?
Yeah, I can make a quick shot.
Yes.
Yeah, I think the whole concept of a shoestring budget, it's not a bad thing. It's really, really okay. And a lot can happen even on a shoestring budget. So if anyone else tells you otherwise, I think like a couple of us in this room at least were like living proof that, you know, that there are a lot of steps forward that can be taken. You don't need to be stuck. And I think just not being stuck is a great place to be. So brilliant. Hope that's helpful.
Very, very indeed. Well put. Thank you. Aishwarya, how's your network? Prapti, you want to go?
Yeah, if Aishwarya isn't around, no problem.
Yeah, Prapti, go ahead.
Cool. Yeah, like I'm going to close with what I opened with, which is I don't think any amount of money is ever enough. And, you know, what, you know, constraints, especially money constraints, help me do is identify what's important. I talked about must-haves and nice-to-haves. When there are these constraints, I am able to filter out what must be done and what are the other fluff things around it. So to me, I don't see the constraint as a roadblock. I see it as just filtering it out and, you know, the risk of being, you know, using cliches, penny saved is a penny earned and all of those things. So I don't see it as, you know, a problem.
Fantastic. Yeah, age-old wisdom always works. Hey, great. So it's been wonderful having you all here. I learned a lot listening to all of you. And let me invite Geeta to come back and talk to us as we conclude this fascinating session today. Geeta?
Yeah, thank you so much, Hema. This has been a very, very fascinating event and conversation. And I felt like it was just very open-minded and really truthful and sharing of the facts and experiences. It was great. And the questions were also brilliant and wonderful questions. And so now it is time for me to thank everybody. And so first I'll start with Chaitali and Shreya on Thai. Shreya is the Thai program manager for the TWE event, and of course Chaitali is the program manager for the NSRCell/ Goldman Sachs event, and both of them have worked very, very hard in the behind the scenes. They're like silent heroes, you know, heroines I should say, working behind the scenes and for making this happen. And you know, Thai always, Hema, Thai charter members and Thai, you know, other SIG leaders always bragged about, oh, we had an event where we had 90 people, 100 people participating. Today we have exceeded 100 people participating in this program. Wow. Very, very excited about this. I think all of you, you know, collectively made this happen. Very, very exciting. And Hema, you have done a very, very good job in guiding and you know, asking the right questions, bringing the right you know, ideas and thoughts from our speakers, and of course our panel speakers, you know, Akshetha, Prapti, Aishwarya, you know, you ladies did a wonderful, wonderful job. There's so much to learn from all of you. You have so much insights to share and more to share also. And of course, we wish Vasanthi Palanivel. She was the winner of the 2020 TWE Bangalore business plan competition. And she's unwell and she was not able to attend today. And and now we will tell you a couple of course, Suresh, for making this happen on the IIMB NSRCell side. Thank you so much. And one other lady, I'm forgetting her name, Sushmita Ghosh. She's also a manager for the program in NSRCell. Thank you all so much. And what we will do from Thai is we have recorded the session. We will take the highlights and we will type it up and we will share it with everybody for those who listened and for those who want to know more about this. And we will do that. Thank you all very much. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful session. Thank you, Hema. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Geeta. Thank you. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Geeta. Thank you for Thank having you. Us. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Geeta. Thank you. You're welcome. You're welcome. Take
Thank
care.
Thank you.
Take care. Bye-bye. Yeah. You are our stars, ladies. So yes, this indeed. Is great. This is great. Thank you so much. Thank you.